Hey everyone, it's Ahmed Azad here. Welcome to another episode of Voices from Palestine with the Tamid Institute for Community Education. This week, we're going to do something a little bit different. Our episodes so far have been panels of young people talking to us from Gaza and other parts of Palestine. But today, we're going to do something different and bring it just to one guest to get a little more personal about their professional life and about their everyday life in Gaza. So my guest today is a young 20-year-old student from Gaza named Farah Miqdad. Hi, Farah. Good morning. How are you?
Hi, Ahmed. How are you? Good morning.
Hey, so all right. So I read your profile. It said you're 20 years old. You're a medical student. You studied in Armenia. Now you started a charity. All kinds of I mean, you know, I know we Palestinians are overachievers, but start me from the beginning. So you lived in Gaza your whole life?
Yes, I lived in Gaza for about like 15 years or 16, let's say. And then I got the scholarship to attend United World Colleges, Armenia. So I traveled and lived there for 2 years. I studied in a boarding school, studied IB, and then got back to Gaza, got into medical school here. And now I'm in my second year.
So you finished, so you finished high school in Armenia. You went to go finish high school there.
Yeah, exactly. I finished.
And are you originally from Gaza, or is your family refugees into Gaza from 1948?
They are refugees into Gaza. We are actually from a young village by the sea called Hamama.
Hamama.
Yeah.
Like the bird, like Hamama.
Exactly.
And so your family came to Gaza in 1948, and you grew up there. Why did you leave just for the, I know some people leave sometimes to go to college, but why did you leave just for the last 2 years of high school?
Well, since I was young, I got first into Access Micro Scholarship where I learned English, and then I started looking for opportunities to help me get into colleges outside Gaza. So one day I was scrolling down my Facebook and I found this ad about an international school where all nationalities gather in one place, where you can get a high quality education. So I said, I'll take my chances and apply and see where it will take me. And then when I applied, I got there, met international people, got to know more about studying abroad, the systems and all these things, applied to colleges out there, but unfortunately, due to some financial matters, I wasn't able to continue my education outside Gaza. So that's why I decided to get back.
Got it. And, you know, we know there's a lot of Armenians in Palestine. But when you went there in Armenia, I'm just curious, how were you received as a Palestinian by the society in Armenia?
Well, although there are lots of Armenians in Palestine, I've never got to meet one of them because most of them live in the West Bank. And right. As you might know, we can't reach the West Bank. So when I got into Armenia, they were welcoming, very welcoming. And they started asking questions about Palestine, what's going there, how's life there, and their everyday life. And then I introduced them to Palestine and they told me more about the Armenian culture, their everyday lifestyle and these things. So then I got to know that there are lots of connections between Armenians and Palestinians, actually. Their cultures overlap and there are lots of common things between us.
Yeah, there have been Armenians in Palestine for over 1,000 years, actually. And especially a lot more after their genocide 100 years ago. And there's actually a lot of connections between Palestinians and Armenians, other than the fact that, you know, I don't know if you know this, we'll tell the viewers this, Farah. You know, when they were rebuilding the Qubbat al-Sakhra, the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem, it was Armenians who helped rebuild that.
Wow, actually, I've never known that.
You know, the Armenians who live in Palestine now, they're part of Palestine. They're not seen as a separate sort of group. They're part of Palestine. So let me ask you this. So you finished high school there and then you came back to Gaza to do a medical school and now you're in medical school.
Well, when I first got into medical school, I had this vision that I want to be a neurosurgeon, especially that this field is not common among females in Palestine, neither in Gaza. And I've first surgeon in Gaza like about 2 or 3 years ago which is very recent. So I knew that I wanted to do surgery, but I didn't know which field yet, because when I got into medical school, I got to see lots of fields, lots of interesting stuff and things I would like to do. But for one thing, I know that I want to be a surgeon, and one from the very few females here in Gaza.
Do you think that we Palestinians need a lot of work on our brains? Like, do we have a lot of brain problems that we need people like you to fix?
Well, I don't think so, but we were for sure get so much affected by so many circumstances that we for sure need more surgeons.
At the university level, do you see in the student body, is there, how's the ratio of men to women? Is it about the same? Is there more men than women, more women than men? What is your experience there?
Well, I guess they're about 50-50 right now, because in my class, for example, we are about 180 students. More than 80 of us are females. I guess females are now dominating the field, so more and more attending and joining to be future surgeons and doctors.
Look, women are smarter than men. I mean, there's no question about that. They are smarter, especially Palestinian women. They're just smarter than men. Women, you know, they're smarter than us. There's no question about that. And so you're telling me that there's 180 students in Gaza that entered this year. So in 4 or 5 or 6 years. So every year, as Al-Azhar University in Gaza is putting out, you know, 180, 200 doctors every year?
Yeah, true. Actually, recently, like about 1 week ago, we got our high school results out, and now we have about 200 students joining us for the year 2020-21.
But wait a minute, to get, you're talking about the Tawjihi results.
Exactly.
To get a high enough score to go to medical school, you have to like get very high in the Tawjihi.
Yeah, well, above 98%.
Above 98 out of 100?
Exactly.
Wow.
Which is
And there's that many people. So, I mean, you know, there's that many people in Gaza who qualified for that?
Yeah, which is great. Like, you hear more and more about their success stories and how they challenged all the circumstances they're living in and still got the highest scores in the national exam. It's like something to be proud of. And I'm really, really happy to see that many people doing that.
Let me tell you a Tawjihi story, Farah. So about maybe 11 years ago, I had come into, you know, I was returning to Palestine for a show, and I hadn't been to Palestine in a long time. And so I came in late from the airport. It was really late. It was around July, and it was really late. And I just got into the house that I was in. I put my head down. I went to sleep. Long flight. You know, I just wanted to sleep, Farah. I just wanted to rest. And then around 7 o'clock in the morning, I heard outside gunshots, people, gunshots and people yelling and screaming. Now, I had not been to Palestine for long, so I said, I don't know what's happening. Did the Israelis enter Ramallah? Is there a new war? Is there something going on? And then all of a sudden, I hear people on microphones as they're shooting guns. They're saying, you know, everything, you know, Ahmed Mansour. The menu 13. I was like, what the hell are you talking? Farah Miqdad, the menu 90. I'm like, they are celebrating and shooting guns for the Tawjihi.
Well, luckily this ain't happening anymore, because unfortunately that caused many injuries, and now it's banned here in Gaza and also the West Bank. I'm sorry that you had to go through this.
I thought I was witnessing a war. I thought I was witnessing the beginning of an invasion. You know, I didn't know. I started looking on my phone. I was like, what's happening? Is there a new war? I was calling my mom in America. I said, what happened? I called them. No, just high school graduation. That's all. Just Tawjihi. So, all right. So now you're in medical school. And I also understand that you have started some charity work and some nonprofit work while you're in the university. Tell me about that.
Well, once I got back to Gaza in 2018, I was like, you know, I've been away for 2 years. I've changed a lot. I've seen what it's like to be outside Palestine and to hear lots about Gaza from other people than your own people. So that kind of affected me. And I wanted to do something. I wanted to do everything I can with everything I have. So I decided that I'd look for any campaigns or any groups that already have work and they know better than me about this in Gaza, because, you know, they've been there for a long time and they're more qualified than me, so they know more about the situation. I went to one of my dad's family friends and I asked him about what they do, and he told me about Al-Ihsan campaign. This campaign has been going on for about like 15 years or 14 years, and they've been doing charity work all along, helping lots of families. They have their names, they do this thing where they go around and ask for people whom, like between them, people are known for needing some help or they're a little bit poor but still they didn't have a job or something like this. So they write their names down and they collect it and use these records and data to collect donations and then help these people out. So I told him, look, I have some abilities. I've worked in community-based projects before, so I'm here to help. Tell me whatever you need and I'm gonna help you. So he told me to join the group, and then I started to know more about this, their work process, and I decided to work with them. During Ramadan, we have this campaign where we work on feeding those families whom they need help. We collect donations, we ask people if they have any extra food or anything they would like to donate, and then we gather this stuff in one place. Usually it's one of our friends' houses. We gather there, sort out the food, organize the packages, and then we distribute them to these families, to their doors. So there now, are some
Farah,
people...
You know, Farah, people think about Gaza, and you know, every place in the world has people who need help, you know, every place, whether it's America or Gaza. But people think about Gaza as a place where everyone needs charity, all 2 million people, but you are in Gaza doing charity. So, I mean, to educate our viewers a little bit of, you know, yes, we have a group of people in Gaza that need help, but is all of Gaza a place where there's all kinds of poverty and all kinds of hunger, or is it sort of a normal place functioning with normal problems, but you just have these, you know, these other problems where you can't move and all that kind of stuff? But is it a place where everyone is hungry all the time?
Well, you know, the financial situation or the economic itself is something relative. So within Gaza, you find people who are better than others. So you can find people who have, you know, in middle class, but they can still help people who are like below or poorer than them. So this is how it works. If I find someone who is in need more than me, I'm going to help them. Right. So most of people think like this. Not everyone needs help, for sure. Some people have exactly what they need to feed themselves and their families. Some others have a little bit more where they can feed other people. And some don't have any source of income to feed themselves. So, you know, it's a kind of levels where the highest is not compared to be the best among the world, but still they can help others.
Yeah, but they're better than others. Any society has those kinds of, you know, levels in their society. But Farah, you live in Gaza. There's so many problems. There's so many, like, you know, things are going on. What makes you want to help other people? Don't you have your own problems that you have to deal with? Like, what makes you go out there and say, I need to help other people, even though you live in Gaza, which everyone sees as a place that needs help, right? But you say you need to help other people. Why? What motivates you to go do this?
Well, personally, that's actually a kind of funny story. So when I was a little, I used to complain a lot about everything. So I don't want this candy. I want the more expensive one. I don't want this. I need a new dress every now and then. And my mom used to be like, Farah, you need to look at people who are in need more than you. So this new dress, you can get this one, but maybe... you can. Other people don't get a dress in a year or in a year and a half. You should stop comparing yourself to people who have more than you, and look into people who need more than you. Yeah. So But and then time by time, my mom always used to say this to me, and I wasn't convinced when I was a little girl. I always said, like, why do I always have to look into people who are like in need more than me? Can't I just challenge myself and be like those who are better than me? And then she was like, well, you can do that, but at the same time, you can't ignore or neglect those who are below you. So you have to do something for them and then do something for yourself. So,
yeah, it's always our parents, right? That's one day we wake up and we realize, you know what? They knew what they were talking about. They were smart. For you say you did it at 20. For me, it took way more before I realized my parents. I was way older before I realized but let me tell you how my mom used to do it to me, Farah. Your mom did it in one way. My mom did it in another way. My mom would make us dinner every night, and every Arab dinner has rice. Every Arab dinner has rice. And I would eat the rice, and sometimes I would leave a few pieces of rice. Habba aw habtayn ruz al-sahn. And what would she say to me? Finish all the rice. I say, why, mom? She would say, because not everybody has rice. And so you need, and that's how I got fat. that's how I got fat, because you have to eat. And now I just eat all the rice, and then I ask for more rice, and then I eat more rice, and I eat all of it. But, you know, yes, this is something that I think every Palestinian mom, because even though, you know, I got lucky, you know, we came to America and I didn't really need anything when I grew up. But even, you know, even though you grew up in Gaza, you still had a lot more than what your parents had. And so they're trying to say to you, hey, appreciate everything that you have. Right.
Sure. Well, I hear stories from my grandma, and then I hear stories from my parents, and it's always that they've lived a harder life than ours, and we always have to appreciate this because they didn't get to have it.
Yeah, this is, you know, and they say that now, they're probably right, but they say it a lot too, right? They make us feel bad about, you know, they make us feel bad. My dad still does that. My dad says, Amer, you know, I used to walk to school 5 miles. And I know he's lying. I know he's lying. I know it's not 5 miles.
Well, hearing this, I started to think that maybe my dad and yours went to the same school, because that's all I hear.
It seems like every Palestinian dad had the same problems. So Farah, I understand there's a charity campaign that you're working on that you'd like to tell everybody about.
Yeah, sure. There's a Lehsan campaign that I'm working on. And right now, it's been 14 years for our Eid campaign, where we give children new clothes for Eid. As you know, all of us have these clothes that have been sitting in the closet for more than a year, and I guess it's time for everyone to look into their closets and get out these clothes and give them to someone who would make them happy and bring them happiness with this Eid coming up. So right now we're working on this campaign for the 14th year so far, and collecting the clothes, and hopefully by the end of this month, we'll give these children and families the clothes that will bring them happiness.
Before I let you go, is there any sort of last messages from living in Gaza and doing the charitable work that you would like to send to everybody who's watching?
Always do what you think is right, because you always have something to contribute with. That's one thing. Another thing, right now, I can see that more and more youth are being more involved in charity work here in Gaza. So whenever you hear about someone who are starting a campaign or trying to help, if you have something to help with, just go there and help them. And there's always something that you can give.
All right, everybody. Thanks for joining us here on another episode of Voices from Palestine with the Tamid Institute for Community Education. Please go onto my Facebook page, watch all the old episodes, and I'll see you soon. If you had a charity drive where you asked people to donate shatta, do you think that you would get a lot of donations?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Everyone has extra shatta.
Exactly. I can't imagine a house without shatta.